Dunque, I'm off to Wien, leaving ancient and Renaissance Italy and my love Firenze behind. A taxi ride along the Via San Jacopo, on to the Via di Santo Spirito, past my beloved Olue Convivium, across the Ponte Carraria, to the Stazione Centrale, the Santa Maria Novella, for the Midnight Express. It's a long train ride from Firenze to Wien, an overnighter. I sack out, but not before giving my British passport to the porter. He ain't gonna get my US one. He'll show it to the Viennese customs immigration folk in the middle of the night, so I won't have to be rousted. Now to dream a dream. Out of time, in dream time. Time to learn, time to remember, expand, knowledge, learning. When was Austria? What is Austria? Who is Austria now? Austria, such a small country, yet with a huge history. After the Roman occupation, it became Charlemagne's in 788 and bequeathed to the House of Babenberg in 1156. It was elevated to a duchy and added Styria in 1192. But by 1246, the family Babenberg was extinct. Ottokar of Bohemia controlled the area then and added Carinthia. In 1278, the first of the Swiss Habsburgs, Holy Roman Emperor Rudolf I, King of Germany, defeated Ottokar. Yes, the Habsburgs were Swiss, not German. Holy Roman Emperor Frederick III, 1415 to 1493, King of Germany and Hungary, married off his son, Maximilian, to Maria of Burgundy, thus acquiring the Netherlands, and his other son, Philip the Fair, to Joanna of Aragon, and acquiring Spain, Naples, and the New World. Thus began the saying of the Habsburg dynasty, Bella Gerant Ali, to Felix Austria, Nube. Those Episcopalians who failed Latin, I will translate. Let others make war. You, happy Austria, marry. Holy Roman Emperor Charles V, 1500-1558 of Germany, and Charles I of Spain, divided his possessions. To his son, Philip II, he gave Spain and the Netherlands. Remember, Philip II was the architect of the ill-fated Spanish Armada, though the Armada had two good side effects. Black-haired Spaniards begat black-haired Irish women. More importantly, Cao de Agua, like my Fantasia, Portuguese water dogs, begat Wheaton Terriers. To his brother Ferdinand I, he gave Austria, Bohemia, and Hungary, and the title of Holy Roman Emperor on his death. As you can see on the map, Austria is growing. Ferdinand's titles included Ferdinand, by the grace of God, elected Holy Roman Emperor forever, August. King of Germany, of Hungary, of Bohemia, Dalmatia, Croatia, Slavonia, Rheinland, Serbia, Galicia, Lodomeria, Romania, and Bulgaria, and Prince Infanta in Spain, Archduke of Austria, Duke of Burgundy, Brabant, Styria, Carinthia, Carignola, Margrave of Moravia, Duke of Luxembourg, and Upper Lower Silesia, Württemberg, and Teck, Prince of Schwabia, Princely Count of Habsburg, Tyrol, Ferrete, Khyber, Gorizia, Landgrave of Alsace, Margrave of the Holy Roman Empire, Enns, Burgau, the Upper and Lower Lusatia, Lord of the Wendish March, Pordenone and Salines. His influence spread with the marriage of his 15 children. All but two survived and married well. Marie Theresia, 1717 to 1780, Grandmother of Europe, Archduchess, Queen, and Empress, eldest daughter of the Holy Roman Emperor Charles VI, in 1736 married Duke Francis of Lorraine. He succeeded Charles VI in 1740 and became Holy Roman Emperor Francis I in 1745. Charles's pragmatic sanction allowed Maria Theresia to inherit the titles and lands Charles had governed. The sanction was signed by all the major European rulers. However, Frederick II, the Great, King of Prussia, reneged. Thus followed the War of Austrian Succession, in which Prussia took Silesia, now part of Poland. All was settled in Marie Theresia's favor by the Treaty of Aix-la-Chapelle in 1748. Not far from the western Polish town of Głogów in Silesia is Dalkow, a hamlet, which my best friend Peter Munch and I visited in 2000 to look over the family's one-time 4,500-acre Guta estate. In the nearby hamlet of Grosgau is the family's parish church. Peter's father donated the stained glass window above the main entrance. On the left-hand wall is a memorial from the War of the Austrian Succession dedicated to Austria's most famous general of the time, Reichsgrafs Feldmarschall Maximilian Ulysses von Braun mit ein E am Ende, an exiled Jacobite Irishman. The 7 Years' War in Austria, called the Third Silesian War, 1756 to 63, was between France, Austria, Sweden, and Saxony against Frederick II, the Great, of Prussia, Russia, and Portugal. Marie Theresia wanted Silesia back, but didn't get it. She further lost Saxony to Freddie Maximus. On the other side of the Atlantic in 1754 was what in America is known as the French and Indian War, in New France as La Guerre de la Conquête. The British took Fortress Louisbourg on Cape Breton Island, Nova Scotia, in 1758, and Quebec City on the Plains of Abraham by General Wolfe, beating Montcalm in 1759. Montcalm's boss was Pierre-François Marquis de Rigaud et de Vaudreuil, governor of New France. He was the one who delayed sending reinforcements to the Plains of Abraham. Shame on him. He was first cousin to my five-great-grandfather, Michel Chartier de Lavignère, builder of Fort Ticonderoga, and the only person elevated to the rank of Marquis in Canada. The Marquis was aide-de-camp to his cousin, the governor of New France, the Marquis de Vaudreuil, at the Battle of the Plains of Abraham. The Marquis de Lavignère's son, Michel Eustache Gaspard Alain Chartier, became the third Speaker of Canada's House of Commons and the first to speak up for French Canadians' rights. My family has been well connected to Canada's earliest history, going back to the arrival of the patriarch, Louis Théard Chartier de Lavignère, in 1651. He was the Attorney General and father of Canadian magistracy. Back to Marie Theresia and her family as Grandmother of Europe. Over the course of 20 years, she whelped 17 brats, of whom 13 survived infancy. We'll only look at the 8 who reached adultery and married and had issue. The eldest child became Emperor Joseph II on Marie Theresa's death. Born in 1741, the fourth child, the previous three, died in childhood. He married twice, first to Princess Isabella of Parma, who died in 1763, then to Princess Maria Josepha of Bavaria, who died in 1767, while Joseph lived till 1790. Next is the Archduchess Maria Christina, born in 1742, died in 1798, married Prince Albert of Saxony, Duke of Teschen, who died in 1822. The third was Archduchess Maria Amalia, born in 1746, died in 1804, married Ferdinand, Duke of Parma, Piacenza, and Gustala, died in 1802. Yippee! They got Parma back! Then came Emperor Leopold II, Duke of Tuscany, born 1747, died 1792, married Infanta Maria Luisa of Spain, who died in 1792. Now we're more than halfway through them with Archduchess Maria Carolina, born 1752, died 1814, married King Ferdinand IV of the Kingdom of the Two Sicilies, and one of the two plunderers of Pompeii. The other, Lord Hamilton, as ambassador to Naples. You know, Lady Hamilton, Lord Nelson, the ménage à trois. The sixth child, Archduke Ferdinand, born 1754, died 1806, married Maria Beatrice Ricciarda d'Este, heiress of Breisgau and Modena. The seventh, Archduchess Maria Antonia. You know her as Marie Antoinette. Born 1755, guillotined 1793, married the ill-fated Louis XVI of France. The last and not the least, Archduke Maximilian Franz, Archbishop Elector of Cologne, born 1756, died 1801. All the others had issue. This one, as far as I'm aware of, had none. All in all, Mary Teresa's children married well for the benefit of the empire. As to love, who knows? We must now move on to the end of the empire under Franz Joseph and Sisi. Mary Theresia died in 1780. Her son, Joseph II, succeeded her. He only lasted 10 years and was followed by his brother, Leopold II. He popped off 2 years later, and his son, Francis II, took his place till 1835. On his death, his son, Ferdinand V, or the First, depending. If you're interested, look it up. He abdicated in 1848, and his nephew, who you've all been waiting for, Franz Joseph, took over the throne. Just before he became emperor in 1848, he served under the famous General Radetzky at the Battle of Santa Lucia in the First Italian War of Independence. Italy lost the war at the Battle of Custoza. On being crowned, he and the Russians put down the Hungarian Revolution of Lajos Kossuth, folk hero to Hungarians, yet not a very nice man. Hungary lost in 1849. Charles Albert, King of Sardinia and Savoy, seeing Franz Joseph fighting the Hungarians, went to war again against him. This time, Radetzky delivered a knockout punch at Novara in 1849. The king abdicated in favor of his son, King Victor Emmanuel II, and went into exile. In 1853, there was an assassination attempt by a Hungarian nationalist pissed at Hungary's defeat. The Hungarian Liebenyi tried to stab the emperor in the neck. He was brought to his knees by Count O'Donnell, another Jacobite, and was detained by a butcher, Joseph Ettenreich. For saving the emperor, the First became Count of the Empire. The butcher, von Ettenreich. Franz Joseph was smitten by Duchess Elizabeth of Bavaria, of Wittelsbach. They were married in 1854 in Vienna. She was a free spirit and traveled much. Both she and Franz Joseph had lovers. They sort of reconciled in 1867 with the signing of the Austro-Hungarian Compromise, and they were crowned in Budapest that same year, but it didn't last. Sisi, as she was known, was much beloved by the Hungarians as she supported their cause for independence. In fact, all her attendants were Hungarian, including Maria Festicius. She was assassinated, stabbed through the heart in September of 1898 in Geneva, Switzerland. Sisi was the forerunner to Princess Diana. Beautiful, not at home with court etiquette, a clothes horse, a complete lack of self-worth, and they both suffered from anorexia. She bore three children, Archduchess Sophia, who died aged 2, Archduchess Gisela, who died in 1932, and the ill-fated heir, Crown Prince Rudolf, 1858 to 1889. He murdered his mistress, then committed suicide in the infamous Meierling affair. The fall of the empire came in six acts. First, the Crimean War of 1853-56, Russia that had supported Austria against the Hungarians, the Lajos Kossuth Rebellion, got no payback from the Austrians. Two, in the Austro-Prussian Seven-Week War of 1866, Prussia won, Austria's power in the German states lost, along with the loss of the province of Veneto, Friuli, Venezia, and Giulia. Three, the signing of the Austro-Hungarian Compromise of 1867 weakened Franz Joseph's absolute power. Four, the death of the Crown Prince Rudolf in the Meierling affair of 1889. Five, Sisi's assassination, 1898. Six, in June of 1914, the assassination of the nephew and heir after Rudolf's death of Prince Franz Ferdinand and Sophie in Sarajevo, beginning World War I. Franz Joseph died in the Schönbrunn Palace in Vienna in 1916. He and Sisi and Rudolf are buried together in the Imperial Crypt in Our Lady of the Angels Church near the Hofburg Palace, downtown Vienna. The last emperor and empress was the nephew of Archduke Franz Ferdinand, Blessed Emperor Charles I and his wife Zita of Bourbon-Parma. They married in 1911, ascended the throne after Franz Joseph's death in 1916, and were deposed in 1919 after World War I and the forcible breakup of the empire with the signing of the Trianon Treaty of 1919. Charles and Zita were exiled and went from pillar to post, ever deeper in poverty. Charles, known as the Peace Emperor, died in 1922 in Madeira. For his devoted Christian life and the seeker of peace of World War I, Pope John Paul II beatified him in 2004. Similarly, after Zita's death in 1989, at the age of 95, there's been a movement afoot since 2009 for her beatification. These were the empire's finest years. The wars were few and brief. It was a time of grandeur. The ramparts of the old city were dismantled and on them constructed the Ringstrasse, Ring Road, adjacent to which were important government buildings and cultural institutions. They were the Votivkirche, dedicated to the survival of the emperor from the assassination attempt of 1853. Then, the Neues Rathaus, the new city hall. The parliament buildings. The Natural History Museum. The Kunsthistorisches Museum, the Museum of the History of Art. And lastly, the Opera House. It was a time of great cultural diversity and freedom of expression, especially for the Jews. Prominent ones include composers Gustav Mahler and Arnold Schoenberg, authors Stefan Zweig, Arthur Schnitzler, Joseph Roth, and Vicky Baum. Doctors, Sigmund Freud, Viktor Frankl, and Alfred Adler. Philosophers, Martin Buber, and Karl Popper. Some other famous artists of the time were, of course, Johann Strauss the Younger, and Gustav Klimt, known for the kiss. Now for Austria's dark past. Austrofascismus. Austrofascism. Based on the Italian fascism of Il Duce, coupled with political Catholicism, it was both anti-communist and anti-Western democratic multi-party. It was authoritarian. From 1933 to 34, Austria had a dictator, Chancellor Engelbert Dollfuss, assassinated in 1934 in front of his family, replaced by another, Schuschnigg, till the Anschluss by Germany in 1938. As a side note, Engelbert was only 5'2". In the coffee houses, if you wanted a small coffee, you ordered eine Schwarze Dollfuss. 10% of all Austrians were card-carrying Nazis, which is a very high percentage of that population. Many were fanatics and got assigned to a number of the death camps. Maria Mandel, the Beast of Auschwitz. Post-World War II Austria has never admitted to its active participation in the Holocaust. Central to the Austrian distortion of its past is the half-truth promulgated by the Allies in the Moscow Declaration of November of 1943. It said that Austria was the first victim of Nazi aggression. Austria claimed it did not exist between 38 and 45. Therefore, it couldn't be held responsible for what happened to the Jews. For that, only the Germans had to bear the burden. Even today, Austria has made a major effort to suppress the memories of its institutional and popular behavior during the war. There is no feeling of shame for what they did to the Jews. Anti-Semitism is part and parcel of Austria's culture, found mainly in politics and the media, both on the left and on the right. What is Austria? Who is Austria now? What you are left with is a country, a mere shadow of its former self, continuously reliving its glorious distant past while denying its present shame.